الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. أما بعد، نتائج الله سبحانه وتعالى لقسيت حوزكم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم رحمة للعالمين ونموذج للمسلمين. يسمي للمسي for the whole world صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم and the model for the Muslims to follow. لأن سبحانه وتعالى بلاز صلى الله عليه محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Over the last 2 days, we have learned a lot about the Messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. We learned about some of the wars. And we finished today, we heard from Atisha, Hafidhahullah ta'ala, about al-Hiq, Kiswat al-Hiq. And we learned a lot of lessons in that. At the end of the world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought Sunnis to the Muslims. They were calm. And Allah used the kissa to separate between the ranks and classify minun wa minafiqun. And everyone knew his place. Afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave more power and space to the Muslims. It was after that that the Yahud, some of them formed allegiance with some of the kuffar of Quraysh. And other Qabail families from the Arab, they came for Ghazwat al-Qadda, Ghazwat al-Ahzab. After that, what happened in Ahzab showed the world that Islam has come to stay, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala definitely is the deen of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So, in the sixth year of Hijrah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is longing to visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was yearning to go for Umrah. So he was longing to visit the house of Allah. Because that house of Allah, all Muslims have right on it. So Allah placed it there, Ibrahim started the building. So the Muslims, all of us have right on it. So the Quraysh cannot say that the Prophet should not come to Mecca, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever he gives it that he's going for an act of ibadah, it should be allowed. And that was why the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his sixth year after Hijrah, in Dhul-Qa'dah, he intended to do Umrah without giving prior information to the Quraysh. So the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wanted to do Umrah. He intended to do Umrah without giving prior information to the Quraysh. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And what informed that was that Allah saw, Allah made the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam see a dream. He saw a dream that he did Umrah. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. لَقَدْ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ رَسُولَهُ الرُّؤْيَا لَتَدْخُلُنَّ الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامَ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ آمِينَ مُحَلِّقِينَ رُءُوسَكُمْ. So, وَمُقَصِّرِينَ. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw a dream that he did Umar with the companions. So if that we are going for Umar, all of the companions we have, that we are going for Umar, so that's how we will qa'da, the sixth year of Hijrah. So we'll be talking about the Sulhul, the treaties of Hudaybiyah. So how did it happen? So that is why we gave this muqaddimah, this introduction. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Hudaybiyah is a place close to Makkah, along the path to Medina. And Hudaybiyah, like Al-Bara ibn Azib said, Al-Radiyallahu anhu, that is the name of the well. Or there are wells around Hudaybiyah. There are wells. So the name of the well in particular place. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the companions about his dream. They were happy. But it's time for the home. So he told them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that tell everybody, go to the villages, announce to them that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going for Umrah. I want us to ask, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So scholars said, why did he want them to go in numbers? The first is that he did not give any permission to Quraysh. So it's a bit careful and cautious. Perhaps if we go, something like a war may happen. So let's go in numbers. So the companions were up, everybody. They got ready to follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Except some of the Munafiqun and some of the Arab. So they were getting excuses. They told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Shagalatna amwaluna wa ahlina. They said, no, we can't go. Our wealth, our animals, God was so busy. And our family, we were the one taking care of them. So perhaps you permit us to stay behind in Medina. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went out for Umrah. So he told the companions, we are going for Umrah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So as he was going sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they got to Dhul Hulayfa. And you know what Dhul Hulayfa was? You know where Dhul Hulayfa was? So Dhul Hulayfa is in the court of the people. Medina. Anyone that is going for Hajj or Umrah from Medina, or that is going to Hajj for Hajj or Umrah to Medina, then that person will do the Ihram. He's going to have the intention and the idea at Dhul Hulayfa. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. animals, those would not, the camels would be using for sacrifice. So that was the one in challenge. Then the prophecy. The traveler is a sword in his case. So they have a sword in the case tied to the car. They don't take other than that. So everyone that will take a sword in the casing tied to the car. So they must step back. So the first thing they were doing was that the sense of Alex to stop the prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that he would not be able to advance to Mecca. So those ones, the Muslims caught them. They caught all of them. They were able to escape them and they missed them. So they caught them, they released them, go back to them. We are calling ourselves, I have not come to fight you. I am coming to do more. So go back to them. So that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are letting come for idea of Ankum, or idea of Ankum, the Bath of Makkah. So when those ones came, they were not able to attack this. The Muslims were able to get hold of them. But after that, the Prophet ﷺ said they should release so that they would get information to the Prophet that he has not come to fight sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has only come to Umrah. So that was the first thing. Then the Muslims continued on the journey. So another set of army were sent. And this one was led by Khalid ibn Walid. So when the Prophet ﷺ got information about their army, at first, they got there as well. So scholars explain that they got there when the Muslims were about finishing Salat al-Duhr. So Khalid ibn Walid was telling them that means they will soon pay for Salat. That Salat is so dear to them. It is when they start Salat they are going to attack them. And that was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the fast of Salat al-Duhr of Surah Nisa. So they were waiting for the Muslims to pray Salat al-Asr. Salat al-Asr is very dear to the Muslims. So let's take it as very, very important. The Prophet is what he called Salat al-Wusta. And that was said in God's words to Al-Fadl. When the Prophet was not able to pray Asr at his time, because they disturbed the Kufar disturbed the Muslims. They were busy with digging a large trench. So all of them, the Prophet was dealing with someone, all of them, they got a big stone, nobody could cut it across. Then the Prophet brought his gigantic bismillah and he cut the stone. So they were busy. So that day, they were not able to pay us at this time. So the Prophet said, Walla Allah, may Allah fill their graves with fire, shantolatina, and salatina musta. They made us so busy. They got us so busy that we're not able to pray Salat al-Wusta at the appropriate time. Salat al-Asr. Salat al-Wusta was Salat al-Asr. So the Khalid ibn Walid was waiting that next week, where we want to pray Salat al-Asr. That is when we get attacked. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be the Prophet of Allah. فلتكن طائفه منكم وليأخذوا اسلحتهم. انا سيدي that we are very want to pay it defy the institute. So all of you should not start together. So you start praying, let the group start with you. And those ones that start with you, let them start praying with their weapons. So then when you are going to Sujud, when you want to come for the next attack, those ones behind should come. As you are exchanging, let them also take their weapons. So all you want to say, this type of style is this one. This Muslim came with another style. Because Allah will continue to help the affairs of the Prophet Muhammad. So after that, the U.S. Muslims sought the opinions of the Prophet that look at what Asia has done. What do you think we should do? Is it that we should go into battle and fight them? Or we should just go there to come out? Anybody that stops us on the way, we fight that person. The Prophet told the Prophet Muhammad that you have come out of Umar. That is what you said in the beginning. So don't let us get busy with other people. Let's go to the woman. And if anyone stops us on the way, we think that person will continue our journey. That was the opinion of the Prophet. So the Prophet accepted that opinion. So the Muslims sort of taking another path. So they call that Al-Wara, a place close to Mecca. So they have to move over some mountains to be able to pass to Al-Wara. So, and those mountains are stones. So, it's not like other desert land, they will move on stones. So, but they have to be patient with the distress to get to Ra. So, when they were able to get there, Khalid ibn Walid lost his pass. He was not able to train the Muslims. So, immediately observed that he went back to Mecca to tell Quraysh, I lost them. So, let's get ready. You don't know what will happen. So, the Quraysh started, they were calling. And they were the first to get to the area. So they were the first to get to the area. So they found one of the best water, one of the best wells for the area, and they localized themselves around that place. So the Muslims were going, after they passed that place, they have become so tired and thirsty. So tired and thirsty. So then another thing happened. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting with them, and he just noticed that his camel, the name of the Prophet camel was Oswa. Oswa, as they were going, Oswa stopped moving. Oswa stopped moving and Wabarakat, and it just go down on his knees. So the companions were saying, Hal, he said to an animal, when you want to stop that animal from doing something, I want to insist that do this. As we used to say, so they say, cat. So the companion said, move. And Oswa stopped to move. What is happening? Oswa did not move. So the companions were saying, Khala atil Oswa. Khala atil Oswa. The ma'ana, la tashkali. Oswa will not go away. Oswa will not go away. And the Prophet Muhammad said, Ma khalat, wa ma dhalika, wa ma kana dhalika khulqan lahu. Qaswa will not say, you will not go on your journey. That has not been his habit. Qaswa is my kind. That has not been his habit. For Qaswa to have stayed here and refused to continue his journey, it's not that kind of that refused to follow the commandment of their rulers. Ma khalat in Qaswa. Qaswa has never stopped to move. And that has not been a way, a manner that Qaswa will behave. Then Prophet said, what I'm saying is that Allah that stopped the feel of Abraham when he wanted to go to Mecca, on the direction to Mecca, Allah stopped that elephant. They did everything they could do. That elephant stopped to move. You know the name of that elephant? Mahmud. That was the name of that elephant that Abraham was upon. Mahmud. Imam Kathir said that in the Diary of the High. So he said, Habasa wa habisu fi. What I'm saying is that it is Allah that stopped Qaswa. And the same way Allah stopped the feel of Mahmud that day, I think that is why Allah stopped Qaswa. So, Al-Hafiz al-Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala explained that the link is that Allah stopped Mahmud so that they will not advance to Mecca. They will not destroy where to be the Abu of the Muslims, where is going to be the Asqa of Tawheed. So, the same way, Allah wants Aswa to stop. Because if the Muslims continue to go to Mecca, it is not Umrah they will go. It's not going to be Umrah. لَعَلَّا هُمْ يَقْتِلُونَ They will fight and blood are likely to be shed. And that time, there were Muslims among the Quraysh. يُخُونَ الْإِمَانَ There are Muslims, men and women, that they did not show their iman because of their people, مُسْتَطَعْفُونَ They could not tell their Muslims, they are doing their Islam secrecy. Why the Muslims go and the battle and see what will happen? Everybody, even those Muslims too, may be doing that one. Because nobody will know. The companions should not be able to differentiate that this one has accepted Islam. The only thing is that he has not been able to show it because it's a weak one. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stopped the Muslims. So Allah said, لَوْ لَا يُجَعْمِنُ مُؤْمِنُ وَلِسَابُ مُؤْمِنَاتِ لَوْ تَعْلَى أَوْهُمْ فَتُصِيبُ Allah said, if not that there are some Muslims there, men and women, you don't know. So if you go to fight them, perhaps you will kill them. So the Prophet understood that this Qaswa stopping is from Allah. So Qaswa stopped. Qaswa failed to move. So after that, our father had to Allah to Allah. The Prophet tapped Qaswa after. And Qaswa stood up and changed direction. Qaswa changed direction instead of going to the path of Mecca. Qaswa changed direction to the path of Medina. So the Prophet followed. Until they got to Hudaybiyah. So when they got to Hudaybiyah, they got to a portion of water at Hudaybiyah. That's where it has little quantity of water. And they have been on a journey that was stressful. They need to take water, drink, and feed their animals. So they started taking from the water. And over time, the water finished. The well became dry. No more water. So they want to tell the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, water has finished. The kufar, the outback source of water, are at Hudaybiyah. What will we do? So there are some rizats. Allah needs some rizats of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first of them was that the Prophet sallallahu gave them one of his arms. He said one of them should put this inside the well. The Bukhari, as he said, the Prophet of Allah Muslim Bukhari, that Prophet has a small layer of water on skin. So he made wudu from that. He made one more. He shook, he gathered water, then he poured it back into the water and told them to pour there. So they poured, and the well began to gush out of water, almost filled with. So the Bukhari took a lot of water. Among the miracles of Hudaybiyah was also that during the time of Salah, we asked him the next day. Jabir ibn al-Sawari went to the Prophet Salah to complain about water also. So the Prophet Salah put his hand into his water and water was coming from his fingers. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The companion said all of them were making ablution from that water. From the fingers of the Prophet Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So that is from some of the miracles of Hudaybiyah. Then after that, then Muslim Sufyan came to the Prophet Muhammad and told the Prophet about how the Quraysh were, how prepared they were to meet the Muslims. Then the Prophet asked them, what is wrong with this Quraysh? Most of the things they have in their wealth, they fought and fought and they almost lose everything they have. When will they stop fighting? When will they stop fighting? Can't you see they were not like the way they were? Now they need people to join them to fight. Why would they stop fighting? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, go back to them and tell them, I have not come to fight. I have come for Umar. So they should allow me to go for Umar. So then he was telling them about times. He said, today let me get you to form. And seeing the courage, perhaps they may want to form some truth with us. Anything they say today, but as far as they are still not to, as far as they are still giving a ta'zim to Allah,
As long as they are still magnifying Allah, any of the condition we give you today, I will assess this. Just as we told the companions, I will set your conditions. So, the first thing, Bismillah alayhi wa sallam, then the Quraysh started to send people to the prophets. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they said, make us in your house. Make us in your house. So when make us in your house came, the Prophet told the companion, this one is God in the fire. This one is a fire. So he told the companions, when he comes, I will say to him what I have said to Musa and Sufyan. So I have not come to fight. I have only come for Umar. Go and tell your people. So he went to tell his people. Like that. That's why would you stop somebody from doing Umar? He has only come because he wants to come and do Umar. Why do you think you should stop him? Then he is in Al-Qamah. He is in Al-Qamah was from the Banu Khuza'a. So he was told to the Quraysh that, okay, these makers cannot achieve anything. Let him go to talk to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he went there. The Prophet knew that this Ibn al-Qamah was the lover of Buddha. When he sees an animal that has been labeled to be sacrificed for Allah, when he sees an animal that has been labeled to be sacrificed for Allah, it's always emotional. He loves that desire that he labeled an animal to sacrifice for Allah. So when he sees Ibn al-Qamah was coming, the Prophet said, he says, it's someone that loves this form of Ibadah. So, place all the camels at front, immediately is coming. Place them under the sun, let him see it. So, when he was coming, he saw all the camels labeled for sacrificing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he saw the camels under the sun. He could not hold the emotion. He did not even get to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He went back to Bish. That, from what you are doing is wrong. See, people are ready to sacrifice to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why are you stopping from having access to Makkah? This is wrong. So the Quraysh told him, he said, you, we know you before, what will you say before? Ittaharub. You are from a family that has allegiance to the Prophet Muhammad. So we can't believe what you have said. Then all white Muslims told the Quraysh, he said, okay, at least you know me very well. And you know my position among you. You know how close and the allegiance between our family and your family. Leave me to go and meet the Prophet Muhammad. So why? So okay. So why Mas'ud came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Was telling the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh Muhammad, why have you done this? Have you had in history that someone destroyed his family, fighting his family, and now coming back again to fight them? Why are you doing this to us? And you now brought new friends from Medina. This ones we go and leave you alone. Abbas did stop. He said, he said, oh sus, live on Isa, or be so last. La la damu wa la la fi'an. Stop here. Oh sus, live on Isa. So he used this word to stop people when they say bad things. So they used to say, oh sus, bidra ummi. So I'm happy to shake it to Om Sus, Bidra, Uzza, our Bidra lads. Why suck the private part of Uzza? Shut up here. What are you saying? We are not going to leave Muhammad, so we are going to stay with him forever. Then Omar looked at our Bible says, he said, who is this one? Then Joseph said, Ibn Abi Qara. That is our Bible. Omar the Masud said, if it is not that, he has something he has assisted me with. I will give you the reply of that statement. Now, let me stop. So, Abbasul Siddiq has paid the year. Remember, I think someone, Abbasul Siddiq paid the year. So, he was not able to say anything. So, then, was not talking with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was aiming to touch the beard of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Mughira bin Shu'bah was standing behind the Prophet Muhammad. The Prophet was sitting down. So Al-Mughira was standing with his sword. So when he wants to touch the beard of the Prophet Muhammad, he will use the base of the sword cover to pierce his hand. So, and he looks at him, who is this one? The Prophet said, if you are Afrika, you don't know your cousin, Mughira bin Shu'bah. It is not that all your evil deeds that you did, I just tell you to pack them before he start to kill this over, kill some people and run away. He killed some people and ran away. When he accepted Islam, the Prophet said, this Islam I accept it from you. But those people you kill, I can't say anything about them. All the while he was told, was one that paid the year. So he was able to talk to the real children. But who must notice something that the way his companions were reacting and behaving to the Prophet, he said, he will not remove his stone except by the woman. They will collect the stones of their hands and they will be able to wipe their face and wash. So, whenever they want to talk to him, they can't look directly at his face. You always know why for his right to the Prophet Muhammad. So, he was amazed. He has been to many cities, towns, kingdoms. He said, I have seen the way they go to Kasra, all of these people, and I have been to Habash. This is not the way they give recognition and respect to their kings. So, he was amazed. Then, the Prophet said to him, what can he say is that there is people, they let me go. I have only come from God. When Allah also came back and said, this man has come for something good. I have only seen him to be good to you. I think you should allow him. What I've seen here today shows me that if you don't allow him, Allah will be disappeared. He's going to come to you. That was to come and insulted. After that, the grace, the king to their senses, they know Allah also will not fight. That today, as you know, what do we see? Muhammad left Medina and entered Makkah without disturbance. And he did Umrah. That is going to make the Arabs to consider us as weak. So what do we do? So before then, the Prophet thought of sending somebody from compliance to the English. He was not sending that. Let's go tell him what he wants. He called Umar. Ibn Abdul Allah. Umar, come and go to the English. Umar said, oh, Messenger of Allah, please don't let him go. That place, presently, there is none of my family that I can say, if I go there, even if you want to do anything, say, this is my brother. And the Quraysh knew how I was to them. I was one of their strongest enemies. I feared that if I went there, they would kill me. So he told the Prophet, let me take someone else instead of Qawwam ibn Affan. So Qawwam ibn Affan, the Prophet called him, go to the Quraysh, tell them what I have come for. So he went to them. So they know him to be a noble person. They gave him a heart. They respected him. So he said, so this is what the Prophet has come for. He gave him other messages. Apart from that, go to other Muslims in Makkah. Tell them that their fortune is coming. And Allah will soon open Makkah again. Just tell them that they should not be patient. So when Allah went to the house of Muslims that they stayed in Makkah, the patience is just a matter of time. Allah is giving this to us. So once Allah got to get, he said, I said, Muhammad, you don't do this Quran. If you want to do Tawaf, you want to do Tawaf, you are going to give it to Allah, you go and do Tawaf. If you are going to Allah, go and give it to Allah. He said, I will just do any Tawaf and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will do us. He's the one that will do for us. We'll do it together. So, the Quraysh, the Tawassul of man, so they get to Uthman and they delay Uthman from going back. Perhaps they wanted to think of what to do. Because at this juncture, this Muhammad is ready to come. What do we do? So the Muslims were expecting that Uthman should have been back. It's taking time. So that they were saying that because the first thing is that Uthman has been killed. Killed again. Then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam decided that now we are going to do bayah. So that's what they call bayah to in the world. Tahta Shajara. So all the companions, one after the other, all of them gave bayah to the Prophet, except Al-Jabr ibn Qais. Al-Jabr ibn Qais was from Bani Salima min al-Ansar, was a Munafiq, and he's going to be very stingy, the very stingy person. The Prophet removed him as the leader of the Ansar of his family because he was a stingy person. So then you can't say a stingy person cannot be a leader. So the bear was done on three things. I want to try to summarize it. They gave bear that this one we are going in Lanox. We are going
is either we die or go mad. And the second one is that we will never run back. And the third one is that we wish to the end of the if it's death, let's pass. And we will never run back. And we patient. So you were coming one after the other. They place their hands on the hands of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it became Uthman. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did the bayah of Uthman for Uthman. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed his right hand on the left and said, "This one is for Uthman ibn Affan." The companion said, "Allah, that this one is better than all the ones we are doing." The bayah of Muhammad was standing in the place of Uthman ibn Affan. Radiallahu anhu. He married two daughters from the daughters of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He married one, she died. He married another one to him, who is awesome. And he was wealthy. He was one of the companions that used his wealth to enter the Jannah. So the Prophet said, "Who will buy people Roma for the Muslim? Where who will have the Jannah?" The father of Allah bought that well. When they got to Medina, the Muslims, most of the water, they did not get adapted to them on time. When they pick from different wells, they fall sick. Only one particular one that belongs to the family from the home. It was the water that they can drink and be better. That is people who matter. Prophet Muhammad said, "Who will buy for the Muslims and have a journey?" So, they thought Muhammad was king. The Muslims were ready to go and attack. Then after that, the Prophet of Mecca will come, "What do you do?" So they agreed to have a tooth sewn. So they sent one of them to come for the sewing. So then he came, Suhail ibn Amr came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to explain the conditions of that tooth. So he came and he said, "What would you do now? I will just give you some of that inshallah. And I will read some of what they agreed on most of time." So he said, "We are going to agree on the truth between we and you." So called a writer, the Prophet called Ali ibn Abi Talib. So the Prophet was dictating, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "I write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim." So Ali ibn Amr said, "La, write Bismillah ar-Rahman." We only know Allah, we don't know Rahman ar-Rahim. So we know Allah, but leave this Rahman ar-Rahim. Right, Bismillah ar-Rahman. The Muslims were saying that, "Why? We are wrong. Why you write this letter?" The Prophet said, "No, write Bismillah ar-Rahman." He wrote it. Then the Prophet said, "Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." He said, "La, if we believe that Rasulullah will not be fighting, so if we are standing as a messenger of Allah, all these fights will not begin. Say Muhammad ibn Abdullah." So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told Ali, "Write Muhammad ibn Abdullah." So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam dictated the first condition, that we are going to come to Mecca to do Umrah now and we are not going to be disturbed. He said, "No, that's not the condition. You cannot come now. We don't want the Arabs to say we are weak. Write that you are going to come next year." The Muslims say, "Ah, why now?" The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam writes next year. So he knows that we come next year to do Umrah. And the second condition, that anyone that accepts Islam from our people and comes to you must be returned back to us. If he did not take the permission of his wife, of his guardian, you must not listen to us. Then the Muslim say, "Ah, how can a Muslim be returned to the Kufa with three people of him?" Then the Prophet said, "Write it down." He later explained that to them because those conditions were true. And said, "And anyone who are not Muslims that need you to come back to us, we will not be coming back to you. If anyone from among us accepts Islam and comes to you without our permission, you must send them back to us. And if anyone of you come back to us, we will not be coming back to you." The Prophet has not said this. So the companion says, "Why? Why is that not cheating? Why would they send him back to us?" And the Prophet says, "Anyone that accepts Islam from them and we send it back to him, Allah will surprise him. Provided they extended Islam with his last, then Allah will surprise him. But if anyone leaves Islam and go back to them, or they have either who walk, it's not supposed to be from amongst us. That is why Allah sent it back away, to where he belongs to. So it's not possible for a Muslim to go back to them." So he said, "So leave the condition like that." Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, and he said,
and there's not going to be any war for 10 years. Nobody should fight for 10 years. We will not fight you, we will not do anything for 10 years. Then you just stand back with you. So, as they were saying that, Abu Janda was the son of Suhail Ibrahim. That Suhail Ibrahim has his son that has accepted Islam. He was shamed, but was able to escape with shame on him. So he got to Libya. So when he got here, so Suhail Ibrahim, the father said, so we want to start applying these rules now. So Abu Janda said, how many slaves have come? Please save me. He said, yeah, go back. So the companions, this one was hard on them. He saw it was to be punished. When Jesus said to him, Abu Janda, go back. Allah will survive. It was hard on the companions. This one we are seeing to be punished. The Jesus said, I already had an agreement with them, so please go back. Allah will survive you. And Allah surprised them. So it was hard on the companions. And that was the agreement that Jesus had with them. And the tools were seen. After that, it was written. After the agreement and the liberation, it was written down. So then the Prophet told the companions, oh yeah, all of them, three times he told them, go and kill your animals and shave your hairs to finish Umar. None of them answered. For three times. That was how the Prophet Muhammad said that he went back inside. Umsalam traveled with him, radiallahu anhu. So she told him, this is what's happened. They did not visit. None of them came to the armor. He said, okay, what you do is that go out, cut your hair, kill your animals, and you see them start to do that. So he was called the one that she said, the hair was shaved, he killed the animal, so all the companions started to do that. So Hudaybiyya made people to know that Muslims are powerful. And it made people to know that Islam is actually the religion of Allah. After that, a lot of people accepted Islam. Imam Zuhri said, Hudaybiyya was actually powerful because the number of people that accepted Islam and the number of people that attended Fath to Mecca, they were close to 100,000. Compared to the number of Muslims at Syria. So Allah used that period to break Islam for the Prophet Muhammad. And other enemies in Medina, Yahud, he used the period to face the power of Yahud and Yahus. Internal enemies were captured during the period of Syria. The Kuwait are not facts. And another lesson we learn from the Syria is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, anything that is from revelation of Allah, you cut down ala al-a'raf al-bashariyah.
Allah's revelation must be placed, must be preponderance above any form of intellect.
Umar was intelligent,
but he has to submit to what was happening. At first, he did not understand that. Umar was blaming himself for going to meet the Prophet.
He said, I found God in myself. When I was thinking that, what God
I fasted a lot. I prayed a lot of never. Hoping that Allah will forgive me. For even going to say, are you not the prophet of Allah?
So Allah
said that. So the Prophet said, what part of what you have to learn here is this. When you are you, when Allah says that, or the Prophet of Allah says something, that is the best for you. Sometimes we may not comprehend why those injunctions are coming. Provided Allah says do that, that is what you should do at that time.
So the Prophet said they carried it as possible because that was what Allah used to prepare them for Fathul Makkah.
And another thing is that Fathul Makkah, the actual Fathul Makkah would have been Fathul Makkah. Fathul Makkah would have been its war. If so the day you are going to watch Makkah, it will have been with war. If this agreement has not happened between the Prophet and the Quraysh, so they said, Surah Al-Hudaybiyah was Fathul Rahman, so that Fathul Makkah will be Fathul Rahman, and it's not going to be Fathul Makkah, it's not going to be the way Allah will conquer Makkah and they will shed blood. The conquering of Makkah will not be with bloodshed because of Al-Hudaybiyah. So they said Al-Hudaybiyah was the actual Fathul. So some people here, they will say, what can they be actually for that? As Muslims, you have to compromise something. So Allah said, it's a lie. That cannot be used for Al-Hudaybiyah. Nobody compromised anything in Al-Hudaybiyah. He didn't think anybody compromised anything. He supposed to have compromised anything. Nobody compromised. He did not compromise. He was acting why? He was acting with revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only thing is that compromise cannot compromise them. So when they later got the understanding of why he did those things, they were blaming themselves for having God to ask the Prophet Muhammad. And that's what Allah says. Sometimes you do not know the reason Allah has commanded you to do something. It is not compulsory you know the reason before you follow. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. When Allah decides a matter, when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decides a matter, if it is truly that you are a believing man or woman, then know that you have no choice in what has been decided in the religion. You must do it like that. Samina wa aqala. You must do it like that. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that it was a fatwa. And that was our Surah Al-Hudaybiyah. So at the end, scholars explain the idea of order
everyone intends to do from Hajj. I asked them, intention is on the way. When you stop, sickness, enemies, the whole family, that's one. And that's already he's going to finish the Umrah at that point. So that he's going to finish it at that point. If he has an animal, he's going to stop at the animal at that point. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Surah Al-Hudaybiyah was not really have to compromise. Because those things were not compromised. They were revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in our case now, if you say, before, so that the Muslims can advance, we must stop some things. Don't you see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, the Shura says, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Muhammad, that said, we must stop some things. Who is giving you the revelation that was not before you advance? Where did you get the revelation that he knows what is not advanced? So, you are this one, it's far to love Rasul. It's whatever you be of Allah's heart. So, that is what you have to do. But as long as you be Allah, as far as you go away from the Prophet, they are on your path. So, that is why. So we pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if possible, for the years, we have used the whole day to describe it to another fish. But I thought of the way of summarizing so that we can get one or two pieces and we learn how to talk about what we're saying in the world.
For that presentation, and I'm making them share to all the speakers. So now, I proceed to the first market by our brother, Tajidin Abdul Salam.